Welcome to Thank God for Monday. I'm Brother Greg from the class of 85, and it's once again my great pleasure to be your moderator for today's show. As this is the first show of 2016, happy and blessed New Year, everyone. We at WSOU and Thank God for Monday want this to be a fabulous year for you and your loved ones. The purpose of Thank God for Monday remains the same this year, to inspire you, our listeners, to take personal responsibility for your professional satisfaction. We want to provide you hope and healing and peace in these turbulent times and motivate you to search deep inside yourself in the quest for fulfillment. Alicia Keys just said it perfectly. There's nothing you can't do. As always, listeners, really up to you to utilize the information we provide. Take full accountability for the decisions you make and a resulting outcome. Now, one of the goals of Thank God for Monday is to introduce role models. Role models of people who take very bold steps to live our Seton Hall motto of hazards head forward, advance despite difficulties. And this is why I'm so elated on this first show of 2016 that Dr. Tracey Wilen, prominent thought leader on the impact of technology on society, work, and career, author of 11 books, and a former Thank God for Monday guest, has called into our show today to share with us her predictions on 2016 hiring trends. Great morning and Happy New Year, and welcome back, Dr. Tracey.
Oh, Happy New Year to you.
Thank you so very, very much. What a great pleasure it is to have you on the first show of 2016. Kindly share with us where you're speaking this morning.
I'm actually out in California and enjoying the new year from the Bay Area.
Well, we thank you so much for getting up extra early to be our guest today. We could spend hours, Dr. Tracey, sadly, we've only got 30 minutes. We could spend hours talking about you, talking about your great books, talking about predictions for this year. But just before we get into 2016, kindly remind the listeners and me, who is Dr. Tracey Wilen?
Oh, sure. So, you know, my background is I have lived and worked in Silicon Valley for many years, and I've also been a researcher on the topic of how technology changes society, work, and careers. And through that, I've conducted research at Stanford University, and today I do a lot of global speaking and writing and blogging and media on some of the ways that we can find jobs in a digital age.
We are so blessed to have you back once again. Now, it's interesting because you have been writing career and hiring predictions for almost 5 years now, if I perceive correctly. What inspired you to do such, Dr. Tracey?
Yeah, and I have been writing it for a long time because what I have observed is that people were continuing to look in traditional places for jobs, you know, the corporate world or local organizations, but really the emerging jobs were happening through really observing the trends in society, whether it's societal trends, technology trends, industry trends, vertical trends. And what I felt is important to really let people understand that if you read and watch the news and listen to the radio, that you can keep up on the next steps. It's almost like skating to where the puck is going to be. Start to look where the jobs are going to be.
Ah, that makes great sense, certainly. I'd be very curious, I'm sure our listeners are as well, about your predictions the past few years. Are there some that have in particular rung true, some that have surprised you at all? Share a little bit about that, please.
Yeah, so most of the research that I do is pretty grounded. So I look at all of the, you know, the job reports and the Bureau of Labor Statistics reports. But I also try to look at some of the trends that people don't expect will turn into actual jobs. And the ones I think that surprised a lot of people that I saw early on, and may have been because I was in the Bay Area, is that we have changed into this on-demand economy and sharing economy. And I think it was on one of our earlier shows I had talked about Uber, which is on-demand driving and people sharing their cars to make money, and Airbnb. And I think these were sort of early trends that I spotted, and I said, you know what, they're solving a problem, whether it's getting a ride or making money by sharing my car or making money by sharing my house to someone who needs a hotel room. these kinds of on-demand sharing jobs will take off, and they have in a magnitude even more than I expected. My goodness, you can pretty much share about anything and get anything on demand these days. And, you know, just to your listeners, I remember reading in the headlines that when the Pope came last year, there was a demand for over 1.5 million hotel rooms that obviously didn't exist in Philly, and Airbnb, you know, serviced that demand. And this is where, you know, these are some of the things that people can make money on and actually job creation.
You know, it's so interesting because I remember that show vividly, and you were talking about the on-demand, and I must tell you flat out that I had my serious, serious doubts. I'm usually much more wrong than I'm right, so thank God that you pulled through again for us, so thanks. We are looking now at 2016, and one of the phrases you use, if I perceive correctly, is senior sensation. Share with us more about this, please.
Sure. So, you know, today there's around 65,000 people turn the age of 65 every day in the U.S. So, you know, some people call it the silver tsunami. We actually now have segments of our seniors. You know, the young old is from 65 to 74, and old is 74 to 84, and our oldest old is 85 plus, which, by the way, is the fastest growing segment. And each segment is creating new kinds of job opportunities and employment opportunities for people because, you know, these are large segments and they have different kinds of needs and services. And so I look at that for people looking for jobs of all ages in the future is keep your eye on seniors and some of the things that job creation comes out of that.
Now, if I perceive correctly, one of the things about seniors is their living spaces, senior living spaces can drive jobs. Do I understand this correctly? And if so, how do you believe this is so, Dr. Tracey?
Yes. In fact, there is a high demand now for retirement communities. Sometimes they're called 50-plus communities, 60-plus communities, 70-plus communities. A lot of them are focused on different kinds of hobbies or interests. You know, I've seen wine country communities. Also, assisted living for people as we get older, we might need more assistance, and so we go to different kinds of communities. And then there's also, you know, a lot of our older people are very healthy, and they want to enjoy their retirement years actually in their home. And this also drives a lot of creation for services. Who's going to do the landscaping? Who's going to do the cleaning? Can we bring in helpers into the home? And the demand for senior housing is actually at an all-time high. When I actually toured many of these facilities and communities last year, and the wait list was about 6 years because the occupancy rate is well into the 90%. So as we retire and age, we're putting on, you know, new kinds of demands on society. And in all of this growth, there are jobs, whether you're working in the communities, creating the communities, construction or services. So I encourage people to look at all ages for jobs that are created by this new phenomena.
Another phrase you use is senior wellness. And do I understand that senior wellness will drive jobs as well? I think you just alluded to a little bit of that, but maybe you can peel the onion a little bit more for us, please.
Yes. In fact, there has been a lot of, you know, statistics stated that there is now demand because of our aging population that registered nurses, home health aides, occupational therapists, and the new one that actually Forbes had mentioned last year was there's incredible demand for physical therapy. And so baby boomers are just creating demand for, in general, more health workers. So I would continue to encourage people, if you're looking for career paths, healthcare will continue to be one of those areas that will expand into a lot of our aging, to support our aging communities as well.
One of the phrases I came across in preparing for this show, plus services. I'm not familiar with this term, Dr. Tracey. Help us out, please. What are plus services?
Well, these are services that actually focus on the fact that seniors actually have more time. And because they're not working anymore, or many, or if they are working, maybe they're volunteering or doing some part-time. So what do you do with your time? Well, you invest it in doing activities that you enjoy. And as a result of that, many of our seniors are driving job creation. So, for example, travel. Our seniors are traveling more and are noted to that, you know, over 8 million more retired domestic travelers and 4 million more retired foreign travelers over the next few years. So it's a big growth, and that in itself creates more jobs in the hotel industry, airline industry, transportation, busing, other kinds of services such as restaurants, you know, different kinds of entertainment. So, you know, just how people are spending their time when they don't have to work in itself is creating job creation.
Did I hear you correctly? 8 million people will be retiring over the next couple of years. Did I hear that correctly? And then creating all these types of jobs and traveling more, et cetera?
Right. So the AARP, which is the American Association of Retired People, estimates that the retirement traveling job will grow over 36% over the next 10 years. So what they're saying is actually it's 8 million more retired travelers domestically and 4 million overseas. And so, you know, if you think about the magnitude of people who will be in our airports, in our cities, traveling for enjoyment, spending money, all of this means job creation, which is pretty exciting for people. So our seniors are actually will be spending dollars and in itself supporting the economy.
That's great to know. Very optimistic. Now, it's very interesting, this next point. It made me chuckle because being the son, the last son of a mother who was the last of 10, I could really relate that in the old days, as people got older, they certainly did not have pets. But from what you're saying, and it sounds like this trend has been reversed, share with us a little bit more about this. Has this indeed reversed? And so what does this mean?
Yes, and I grew up with that generation as well, that, you know, it was a family pet. And then when the family grew up, you know, and the pet passed, that was it. You know, as grandparents or retirees, we don't have pets. But that is reversing, and our baby boomers are filling their empty nests with pets, and that itself is driving the industry. And not only are they doing it as baby boomers, right, the, you know, our young old, but they're taking their pets with them, you know, as they continue the enjoying, right, having companionship. So, you know, someone to come home to, someone to wake up to in the morning. And if you think about that, that's creating, again, job creation, whether it's pet stores or retail or pet food supply or veterinarian offices or pet groomers or pet walkers. You know, the list can go on. That just by the, in essence, that, you know, our boomers and our older community is embracing pets as part of where they want to spend their time, this is creating more jobs.
Dr. Tracey, once again, absolutely brilliant. I would have never thought of that, but that is really, really, it makes all the sense, certainly. Listeners, for anyone who's just tuned in, happy and blessed New Year. Brother Greg here on Thank God for Monday. Welcome to Thank God for Monday, the first show of Indeed 2016. I'm Brother Greg from the Class of 85. Much, much more important on this landmark first show of the year today, our very special guest, Dr. Tracey Wilen, prominent thought leader on the impact of technology on society, work, and career. She's the author of 11 books, a former Thank God for Monday guest, and we're talking all about hiring trends and predictions for, indeed, this new year, 2016. She's calling in from lovely California. And I'm sorry to say, Dr. Tracey, that it's been about a month now since the tragedy in San Bernardino. One of the things that you say is security is a safe bet to create jobs. Share with us a little bit more about this, please.
Yes, and we've talked about this before, and I'm keeping security on my list because it is in the news every day. And, in fact, right after the Paris attacks last year and San Bernardino, even there in New York, The police set up a counterterrorism squad with the start of 100 people that will grow over to, you know, 500 over through this year. And so terrorism has sort of bubbled up to the top now, or counterterrorism jobs, as one of the fastest growing in the overall job market. And I had mentioned it in previous years because we were starting to see attacks, but now they're almost they're much more frequent and in closer proximity and in magnitude. And so I'm keeping that on the top of my list.
Wow. So as you say, and I recall you have mentioned it in predictions from previous years, but this year it seems like it's in a much different order. It's a bigger prominence, no question about that. Now, each year, of course, you're a great expertise. You kindly cover technology. I'm very excited to ask this question, Dr. Tracey. What are the growth areas in technology for 2016?
So the growth areas that I predict for this year is, one is artificial intelligence. So that's really smart machines. Watson, for example, many people may be seeing the TV commercials over the last year of how Watson is a smart machine that can not only remember things but learn. And this is all about artificial intelligence. I think immersive technology, in fact, a colleague of mine received a TV over Christmas that came with its own 3D glasses so that he could watch sports, right, and games in three dimensions. So I think you're going to see a lot of this, you know, immersive technologies, whether it's watching, you know, Google Maps on your PC and being able to go down alleyways to, you know, Oculus headgear and immersive technology and gaming. So I think that's a big one. And, you know, the other one is drones. You know, they came on the radar about a year or two ago, but Amazon made a big deal about it, you know, two Christmases ago and then this past Christmas, that they really want to see drones in the commercial space to deliver. They want their Prime members to be able to receive packages in under 10 minutes, and they're really putting pressure on the FAA to let them, you know, develop this service. And hopefully by the end of 2016 is, you know, that they'd like to have it. And I think part of it is that, you know, you see drones now in the stores. The cost of making drones has gone down. It's beyond just a toy now. People are embedding cameras in drones. And so I think, you know, this is, you know, an area. In fact, they're predicting that it could create more than 100,000 jobs over the next 10 years. It's an $82.1 billion business. So I think that's something to keep your eye on as well. And a new one that I read about, you know, as I was looking through YouTube and now another site I look at is called Twitch, is that actually people are making money by letting other subscribers watch them play immersive games. So the same way that you and I may watch a cooking show, there are actually people who are making money. If you go to their YouTube channel or their Twitch channel, and you can go into their world and learn how to play games better. And they make money through donations, they make it through subscriptions, they make it through advertising. So there's this whole world that technology is opening up, or what I call the marketplace or ecosystem of other jobs that these technologies create.
You've once again introduced to me a whole lot of new concepts. In particular, I have not heard, is it Twitch or Twitch? Could you spell that for the listeners?
Sure. Twitch is T-W-I-T-C-H, and then, of course, YouTube. And actually, I was reading some of these people make like $140,000 a month. It just depends on how entertaining you are and how many subscribers you have, and then you can get, you know, advertising endorsements. So, you know, you can make money if you are an advocate game player, because you're really teaching other people how to play games, or they come with you, and it's a form of entertainment. And that didn't exist before. That's why I encourage people to always look at the trends. There are traditional jobs, but then there are some unique jobs that, you know, just surface as part of an ecosystem of emerging technology.
That's just amazing. I'll have to take a look at that. One of your predictions, I want to readily admit, I was very surprised to hear you mention that there'll be a demand for blue-collar and skilled workers. Tell us more about this, please.
Yes. In fact, by 2017, there's an estimated 2.5 million new middle-skill jobs that are expected to be added to the workforce, which will account for 40% of all job growth. And that was in a USA Today article last year, collecting data from economic modeling specialists in International and Career Builder. And basically, you know, maybe we have spent so much time emphasizing the college degree that we're forgetting that there are a lot of jobs and good jobs that are available for people who are plumbers, carpenters, electricians, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, repair people, and that actually it's in high demand. And this is one segment where you actually don't need a college degree. A high school degree with skills could be enough, and you know, for you to get a good job. And these jobs pay like $50K and up.
Wow. So some of these are higher paying blue collar jobs then.
Yes. In fact, last year Forbes had a list, and they had a list that I would encourage people, if you have a skill, to look at it, because there are definitely jobs where you can make money, and it's everything from electric to refineries to subway systems to streetcar operators to commercial divers to people working in oil and gas industry to people who repair boilers, furnaces, aircraft, you know, you name it, there's a variety of, you know, skilled workers needed. And, of course, transportation, you know, and I always mention every year because I meet so many people in the transportation industry who keep saying, Tracey, just please keep letting people know we have such shortages for truck drivers, not only short-haul but long-haul drivers. And I was, you know, reading that Amazon will be launching not only in addition to their drones, but they'll also be coming out with their own logoed trailer trucks where they'll need drivers to be able to deliver their products. So there's a lot of jobs in that area.
Working as I do in the career center of a college, it hurts me to talk about this, but I am hearing more and more talk across the nation about the cost benefit of college degrees. And you once again have brought to us very, very nice alternatives, because clearly everyone is not to go to college and make that huge investment or somewhat huge investment, depending on the choice. There are some real opportunities where, as you say, you don't necessarily need a college education, but can make a real contribution to society and support yourself and a family as well. Now, in preparation for this show, I looked into this, I guess, television show, Blue Collar Millionaires. I was totally unfamiliar. Do you see this show as an inspiration for people, Dr. Tracey?
I do. I view it as an inspiration the same way that Shark Tank was an inspiration, you know, starting a couple of years ago. So this is almost like a spinoff. But I got glued to the TV last year watching it. It was a friend of mine who gave me a heads up because he himself identified with the show. He started a business in the Midwest, and it was, you know, it's just a skilled worker in transportation, and he built it into basically a millionaire. And that show shows how people can be entrepreneurial with their skills, you know, and they just showcase a variety of entrepreneurs who maybe aren't working for somebody else, but are skilled enough to be able to start their own business. And the reason why he told me he liked the show is because they really talk through some of the mechanics and show the possibilities that entrepreneurs are not just people who are white-collar or college-educated. Entrepreneurs and millionaires can come from all walks of life. And it's a fascinating show, and I myself got glued to it as well.
What's very interesting, now working in beautiful downtown Brooklyn, it is amazing the entrepreneurs that are just coming all over the place, many of them without college degrees, but they are creating products and services that add tremendous value and are doing quite well financially as a result. Now, along these lines of being your own boss, you suggest that a micropreneur will continue to be a job driver. Share with us, please, what is a micropreneur?
Yes, yeah, so this is someone who really just, creates entrepreneurial, small entrepreneurial activity. So you might remember that we talked about Uber and Airbnb, and these were small, digital kinds of basically marketplace firms. And now they are very large firms. So Uber projects to create numerous millions of jobs a year, and Airbnb will grow by $10 billion by 2020. But there's other places that people can go. Etsy, if people are not aware of it, is a marketplace for crafts people where you can actually make things and sell them. Zazzle is another one. And eBay, people open up storefronts and sell things. So these are like micropreneurs. I've read about, people who start a business, for example, reselling unwanted gift cards, loading music onto people's smartphones, creating digital yearbooks. So this whole idea in a digital world that if you have an idea on how to use technology to solve a problem in a unique and different way, you can make a business out of it. And I think this is very appealing, particularly to our younger generation that may not want to work in the traditional corporate or organization environment. Some referred it to me as, the corporate treadmill. They just don't want to have that. They want to create their own opportunities. And I think you can do that more so today in a digital world than in the past.
The barriers to entry that certainly were there when I was 15 and 20 years old are certainly gone, no question about that. We've only got a couple of minutes. I have two very important last points I want to cover with you. You say that certainly franchising is often overlooked, but you think it's a growing area. A quick prediction for franchising for us, please, in 2016?
I do. I think franchising will continue to grow. The data is out there to support it because I do think that people do want to own their own businesses and have their, own control over their livelihood, but not everyone has that idea. And franchising opens up the door for people to own businesses, get into operations that have operations and marketing at either a small cost, some as low as, $5,000, or a very large cost. And it's in all different areas. And I think that's a way, if people do want to have a business, you can still look at franchising as an opportunity.
We've saved the most important question for last. Dr. Tracey, how can our loyal listeners purchase your latest book, Employed for Life, 21st Century Career Trends, and or contact you?
So my books are on Amazon.com. And my website is TraceyWilen.com, which is TraceyWilen.com. Twitter is @TraceyWilen. Facebook is Dr. Tracey Wilen. And I'm on LinkedIn and encourage people to reach out and link with me.
Dr. Tracey Wilen, author of 11 books, and the latest being the one we just talked about, Employed for Life, 21st Century Career Trends. Thank you so much for gracing us, starting our year off with a bang here, if you will, talking about hiring trends and predictions for 2016. Thank you again. We want to wish you all continued success and happiness as we continue forward in 2016. And certainly this time next year, we'll have to do it again. You always have an open mic here on Thank God for Monday.
Thank you.